position, you know, something grand and glorious happens and you're so blessed and so it's so amazing, and yet you say within your heart, yeah, but if only my daughter were here to be a part of this with us. You know, there's that hard, there's that painful place in the area of your heart. So for Naaman, this incredible man with an incredible sickness. In verse 2, we see, as I've already alluded to, the Syrians, the people of Syria, under the direction of Naaman, had gone out on raids into Israel and had brought back captive a young girl from the land of Israel, and she waited on Naaman's wife. And so we have an Israelite girl. The text tells us she is a young girl. And it would seem to communicate to us that maybe on the low side of a teenager kind of thing. 9, 10, 11, 12, somewhere in there, maybe 10, 13, something through there. And notice that she is a captive of the Syrians. She's a captive of the Syrians. And notice that she waits on Naaman's wife. So she's been brought into Naaman's household, a captive of Israel, and she's been brought into Naaman's household to wait upon his wife, to be a servant girl to her. And she must be doing that and must be doing it well. There must be some integrity about her, because Naaman, number two guy in the entire nation, and he's taking care of his wife, and this girl is taking care of his wife, and so, you know, if she wasn't doing a good job, she wouldn't be there very long. And she said to her mistress, this young girl, verse 3, if only my master, if only Naaman were with the prophet who is in Samaria. We now know, because of reading through this, that she's speaking of Elisha. And notice that she says, if only my master were with the prophet. We have the definite article there, the prophet. There were not many prophets wandering around Israel during Elisha's day. It was Elisha. He was recognized to be a prophet of God. And she says, if only my master Naaman were with the prophet who was in Samaria. Samaria was the capital city of the 10 tribes of northern Israel there. So we would find that Elisha has positioned himself within the capital as God has placed him in these days of Israel to be a representative for God, to continue to manifest God's glory, his power, his might, his message to the people of Israel, calling them to repentance. And notice that she says, for he, speaking of Elisha, would heal him, Naaman, of his leprosy. That's a pretty good offer. Pretty nice news. And there's a response to that. As she would say this to Naaman's wife would have gone to Naaman and shared this with him, because in verse 4 we read then, and Naaman went in and told his master, Ben-Hadad, saying, thus and thus said the girl who is from the land of Israel. Two things I just want to note here, kind of a side note. First of all, that the type of man that Naaman is, being used by the Lord, great and honorable, a man of valor, as he would go on these raiding parties into Israel, it would seem that Israel's testimony and witness for their God, the one true God, is so terrible, if not, we might say, non-existent, that to this point, Naaman has not heard of Israel's God. Or if he's heard of Israel's God, he's certainly not heard that there's a way to Israel's God through the prophet Elisha. So that when this news comes to him through the servant girl, it would appear to me from reading the text that he's very quick to respond. But watch this, I think, even more importantly for this young servant girl, in the same spirit of Daniel, taken captive by Nebuchadnezzar, Joseph, sold into slavery there in Potiphar's house, the life of this girl and the testimony of this little captive girl from Israel are consistent one with another. That when she, in her youthfulness, communicates to her, you know, to Naaman's wife, hey, there's a prophet in Israel who can deal with this leprosy issue, she is believed. I think there's such a powerful point of application for us, although this is not why we're going through the text this morning, that her life and her testimony was consistent. That she lived a life, that she had a walk with the Lord, that when she talked about God, people listened because they looked on at her life and they saw, yeah, you know what? there is something about you. There's something different about you in your faithfulness, in your service, in your walk with your God, that we see the fruit of that. We can believe what you're saying. You know, you're not the worst slacker servant that we have here around the house, you know, and just, you know, a total bum, and we were thinking about getting rid of you anyway because, you know, you're just totally useless to the family. No, her word carries weight. Oh, man, that our life and that our testimony for the Lord Jesus Christ would be powerful to the people that would know that we are Christians. That when we speak, whether they would respond positively or not, they would know within the depths of their heart, I believe what he is saying, I believe what she is saying, because I see it in their life. So the king of Syria, Ben-Hadad, verse 5, said, go now, and I will send a letter to the king of Israel. This is King Joram or Jehoram, however you know, if you're from the north or the south. The north and the south, we're always naming things differently, I would find out, here in our own country. But here, Jehoram or Joram, Ben-Hadad says, you know what, I'm going to send a letter of introduction. Send a letter to the king of Israel for you. And so Naaman departed and took with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 changes of clothing. And this comes out to a couple hundred thousand dollars worth of valuables that he's going to travel with. And Naaman, he brought the letter to the king of Israel, Joram, which said, and here the letter said, now be advised when this letter comes to you that I've sent Naaman my servant to you, that you may heal him of his leprosy. So we got a little bit of a problem here, is that Naaman is supposed to be going to the prophet of Israel, Elisha, who Joram knew and hated, you know, and that's where the letter is supposed to be going. But the letter is addressed to the king and their son, who said, you know, it's just a letter of introduction, that Naaman, when he got to change, you know, the letter would get him entrance to the king of Israel, and then he'd be able to share his story. Hey, I hear you have a prophet here that could heal me of his leprosy, and this sort of thing. But be that as it may, Joram looks on and goes, my goodness, what? This guy, he, what? When the kid happened, when the king of Israel, Joram, read the letter, look at this, he tore his clothes, the sign of great mourning, and he said, am I God to kill and make alive that this man sends a man to me to heal him of his leprosy? What I find curiously insightful about this is that Joram recognizes that the God of Israel has the ability to kill and make alive. If you go and you read the rest of Joram's life, he didn't really live his life like he recognized that and believed that. I mean, in the moment of his consternation, in the moment of rending his clothes in mourning over just the gravity of the situation, kind of interesting that what would come out of his heart. Am I God to kill and make alive? It's interesting, Joram's daddy would be King Ahab, you know, the one married to Jezebel. The guy was one bad, wicked dude. His wife, even worse, you know. And yet Joram would know of the one true God, and he would know somewhat to, you know, of his abilities. And I just find it fascinating that he recognizes that God has the ability to do these things, but he's not God, Joram isn't, and he can't do these things. And he says, therefore, please consider and see how he seeks a quarrel with me. At this point in time in the history between Israel and Syria, there's a momentary peace between them. The Syrians are kind of running these party invasion, these raiding parties into the land and this sort of thing. But for all intents and purposes, there's not war between them. There has been war before this. There will be war after this. And Joram, he sees, he believes, he thinks that Ben-Hadad is really just looking to pick a fight. And it's fascinating to me as well that he never considers Elisha himself. He doesn't look and go, man, you know, this is really something for the prophet of God. This is really something, you know, I need to look into this. I need to, you know, we need to get Elisha in here to deal with this. And he totally misses the prophet of God, totally misses the spiritual avenue that he could take. And Verse 8, so it was when Elisha, the man of God, loved that phrasing. May we each, men and women, be referred to as that. Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel, Joram, had torn his clothes, that Elisha sent to the king. He sent a message to the king.